what time it is? It's 5 p.m. Eastern. Are you aware of what's happening right now? Today, we're going to be going over the timeline of Elon Musk's takeover of Twitter.com. This is going to take a while, and we're going to end it by talking about some neo-Nazi stuff, as is, you know, what we do here. But this is important because of the timing of this, and we'll get to the timing of it in short succession. But the main thing that we need to talk about is the fact that the world's richest man has bought the most popular social media platform for young people that is not TikTok. Twitter is not the biggest social media website. It barely even cracks the top 10 globally. But its influence is incredibly important. During the Donald Trump administration, it was the number one source. It was the way that the president got all of his information and all of his dumb thoughts out there. Twitter is the place where all the politicians live. It's the place where they are the most accessible. It's the same place where most of the celebrities are the most accessible. And Twitter has been bought out by an idiot. End of sentence. We're going to be talking about Twitter and timeline and the timeline that Elon Musk has here because it is incredibly important to understand what exactly is happening. Because unfortunately, Twitter has taken over reality for many people, and it's a big reason why I hope that it dies. I'm going to make a prediction on this show. Twitter is going to be dead within a week. And we're going to go over that and a bunch of other stuff throughout this episode. This is Nic Does A Think. The timeline begins at the beginning of the year, in April of 2022. On April 5th, Musk disclosed that he had purchased more than 9% of Twitter's shares on the open market. At first, he's offered a board seat. That plan quickly falls through, and Twitter decides to adopt what's called a poison pill strategy. Now, the poison pill strategy is used to fend off a hostile takeover, but Twitter users, being incredibly savvy legally, made up a bunch of stuff about it. This ended up being a distraction. That's the reason why I hope it dies. But again, we'll get to that. Musk subsequently makes an offer to buy Twitter for $54.20 a share, or roughly $44 billion. It is important to note that the actual estimated cost of Twitter, according to a third-party analytics firm, is $22 billion. So he overpaid for this entire platform by $22 billion. Billionaires should not exist. He did not earn billions of dollars. This is whatever. I'm getting distracted. Twitter has extraordinary potential. I will unlock it, he adds. He says that he will fund the deal through a combination of cash and borrowing. At this point, shares in Musk's automotive company, Tesla, began to decline. By mid-November, they will have lost close to half of their value. By April 25th, Twitter decides to accept Musk's offer. The Twitter board conducted a thoughtful and comprehensive process to assessing Elon's proposal with a deliberate focus on value. The Twitter independent board chair, Brett Taylor, said in a statement, "The proposed transaction will deliver a substantial cash premium, and we believe it is the best path forward for Twitter's stockholders." Now, in May and June of the following year, Musk decides he is going to put the deal temporarily on hold because of all the bots. This is basically an excuse. There are a ton of bot accounts on Twitter, but it's not as bad as he was making it out to be. Basically, he realized that he was overpaying by double the actual value of Twitter.com, and he decided to do anything he could to get out of it. So he threw out as many excuses as he could, and he mostly landed on bot and spam accounts on the site, and the fact that Twitter has famously not been very responsive to addressing the issue. Twitter responds by taking Musk to the Delaware Chancery Court, which is the main corporate courthouse in America. This is because Delaware is a clearinghouse for most of the corporate offices in America. Most of the corporations you know and love are headquartered in Delaware, despite the fact that they are probably elsewhere. It's usually for tax reasons. Mr. Musk has made it very clear that he does not believe in the company's lax testing methodologies are adequate, so he must conduct his own analysis, Musk attorneys said in a filing. There we go. The data he has requested is necessary to do so. Twitter denies the claims and continues to forge ahead with the deal. On June 16th, the company invites Musk to an all-hands meeting, which Musk attended remotely. It angers the sea change in the company culture, which would eventually sweep over the business once Musk finally takes over. July and September 2022, unable to come to an agreement over the bots issue, Twitter sues Musk in Delaware court to enforce the $44 billion deal. Musk eventually countersues, once again accusing Twitter of fraud, allegations it denies. A trial date is set for October 17th. Twitter and Musk jockey for position ahead of the October trial, with Judge Kathleen McCormick increasingly sliding with Twitter in key pretrial motions. In October, as the trial gets closer, the markets increasingly predict a verdict in favor of Twitter, because of course. Musk was very obviously lying through his teeth about this deal and very embarrassed that he was overpaying, in my personal opinion. Musk says he will resubmit his bid to acquire the company for $54.20 if Twitter agrees to stop the trial. Twitter declines to do so, but McCormick decides to give the two sides until the end of the month to hammer out an agreement. As the deal nears, the Washington Post reports Musk intends to lay off massive numbers of employees after the acquisition is complete. We will cover this in a little bit. Though Twitter's general counsel tells workers not to believe what it calls rumors, these job cuts come swiftly after Musk's takeover and total about half of Twitter's payroll. We got there faster than I was expecting. Musk also writes a note to advertisers pledging Twitter will not become a, quote, free-for-all hellscape. On October 28th, Musk officially consummates the acquisition, taking over Twitter, and promptly fires key executives, including CEO Parag Agrawal and policy director Vinjaya Gadde. In November, Musk's arrival is notably hailed by libertarians and right-wing pundits. Within 48 hours of taking over, Musk tweets and deletes an unfounded anti-LGBTQ conspiracy theory about the Paul Pelosi attack. Just a reminder, the Speaker of the House, Nancy Pelosi's husband, Paul Pelosi, was attacked in his home by a man who was wielding a hammer. He has since been released from the hospital, but don't forget, a man in his 80s, who is the husband of the Speaker of the House, was attacked, and we've all just kind of forgotten that happened. I'm just going to bring that up real quick, but like, that's really crazy, right? Anyway, despite stating that he has not made substantive changes to Twitter's content moderation policies, advertisers say they will pull back amid, quote, uncertainty about his strategy. Now, this is important to note. He fired the bulk of the content moderators. Now, a content moderator's job is to look at all the stuff that is going out on Twitter and anything that is considered grounds for suspension or expulsion from the platform gets brought to the moderators. So if you have, say, Alex Jones saying Sandy Hook was a false flag operation and he's spreading these lies through Twitter, it is the content moderator who makes the decision pro or against whether or not Alex Jones gets to stay on the platform on the basis of these tweets. And advertisers typically like content moderators. Content moderators are the people who have to look at the really gory, awful things. It is a genuinely terrible job to have. The content moderator is typically someone who has to deal with an influx of genuinely upsetting imagery, and a huge chunk of them do not leave that that profession without some form of PTSD or complex PTSD, because the job is quite literally looking at a screen, going through all the information all day, and suddenly a beheading video pops up, and you can't look away from it. Because it's your job to examine it, and you have to make a fair assessment of, is this beheading video newsworthy? Is it terrorism? Should it be on the platform? Should people see this? And depending on the platform, such as Facebook, for example, content moderators may allow content that is effectively, in one case, a soldier committing suicide. They may keep that up. Because even though it is very clearly and obviously disturbing, it does not violate the terms of service. Advertisers, if nothing else, love the fact that there is at least someone at the helm looking at all this content and making sure that their brands are not being associated with the bad stuff. But what exactly is the bad stuff? We'll get to that later when we start talking about neo-Nazis. I was expecting to talk there, but instead I ran the fog machine again. Woo. On November 4th, NBC News reports that employees who helped fight information were ultimately among those laid off. Musk also launches the plans to begin charging users $7.99 for access to Twitter Blue. Twitter Blue was a thing that had already existed before Elon Musk came along. Before Elon Musk came along, Twitter Blue was famous for having an undo function. Because a lot of the time, the biggest complaint that most users had about Twitter, besides the fact that Twitter is a cesspit, is the fact that once you send a tweet out, you cannot edit it. You can't even make a minor edit. So the undo function was a way to send out a tweet, and then you could pull it back, and if you wanted to fix something, or you decided, I don't want to tweet this, you had, I think, 10 seconds to decide, and then pull it back before it actually got sent out there. People who have had Twitter Blue before the platform did this, ultimately said that it was not worth the, at the time, I believe it was $299 price tag, because the features that were on there were quite limited, and also it was just kind of generally seen as embarrassing to pay for Twitter. Twitter is not a platform that you pay for. Twitter is a place that you go to feel depressed. There is no actual value to Twitter, especially in my opinion. But we'll get to that later. I want to focus on something else very quickly here, and I need to spring this up on the laptop here. First of all, when the Twitter Blue thing was happening, Elon was announcing that Twitter Blue was going to cost $20 a month. And then Stephen King, the famous horror writer behind It, and I don't even know what else he did, Carrie? Oh, yeah, The Shining, too. He went on Twitter, and he's like, no one's going to pay $20 for Twitter Blue. $8, maybe. And that's the story of how Twitter Blue went from $20 to $8. Stephen King negotiated down for all of us. I want to bring up something that happened during this period, because I feel like a lot of people just kind of skipped over this. I want to spend a minute just talking about the fact. Prepare for something kind of jarring here. Hang on here. Apologies, I got to get this thing set up here. I'm so sorry. There we go. Use of the N-word tripled on Twitter in the first week of Musk's ownership. Use of the racist N-word on Twitter increased threefold the first week of Elon Musk's ownership, according to a new study. The investigation by UK-based Center for Countering Digital Hate found that the use of racist, homophobic, transphobic, anti-Semitic slurs increased significantly under the new ownership compared to the 2022 average. In the week beginning October 31st, the N-word was used in 26,228 tweets and retweets, three times the 22 average. During the same period, 33,926 tweets and retweets include the transphobic slur, included a transphobic slur, while 21,000 featured the homophobic insult. It's the F slur. I'm not going to say it on the air, of course. The first week of Musk's ownership saw an anti-Semitic slur and racist terms and appear 2,000, 1,900 retweets, respectively. This is an increase of 23%, 62%, and 77% across the average for 2022. That took place despite Musk's claim on November 4th that hate speech had fallen under his leadership. It very clearly had not. I don't know what to say beyond that. And it's a ridiculous claim to be making anyway. Hate speech increased, as noted here, but you didn't even have to know that because another very famous thing happened that was technically hate speech, but it's like, you know, hate speech against corporations. We're going to get to that in a second here. I apologize that I'm getting all nasally. Apparently, I am not reacting very well to the fog in the fog machine here. So, we're going to get to, there we go. Elon Musk's Twitter company lays off employees across the company. Twitter laid off thousands of employees and departments across the company in a severe round of cost-cutting that could potentially upend how one of the world's most influential platforms operates 1 week after it was acquired by billionaire Elon Musk. Roughly 3,000 people lost their jobs in a single day. And the way that Elon Musk decided who gets cut was that he took all the programmers in the company and he looked at the heuristics and all the statistics of who was programming the most stuff. So he was literally taking the word count of who was doing the most programming based on word count, based on the lines of code that each individual programmer did. And then he decided that he was going to do a bell curve thing and just cut off people who did not program enough. If you programmed a ton, you stayed on. But if you didn't program all that much, you were fired. And you were part of the half of the company that was let go. That's how he did it. And it was such a mess that literally a day after that, they were asking employees who had just been fired to come back. He's the real life Tony Stark. He's just such a genius. He's such a brilliant billionaire. He's so smart. Oh my God, I just love him. He's just so brilliant. He runs five different companies. Can we talk about that? Can we just talk about that for a second? He supposedly runs five different companies. He runs Tesla, The Boring Company, Twitter, SpaceX, and Neuralink. So that's five separate companies that one man is the CEO of. How does he have time to run one of them, much less five of them? What does a CEO do, if anything, if he can do that? And especially if the decisions that he's making are like, you know, it's stuff like this. He just fired half the workforce at this company. That's all he did. You know, he's the richest man in the world. And like, that's the decision making that he did. He's like, oh, we're just going to fire everybody. Okay. So, now we're at my favorite part. Twitter decided to revamp Twitter Blue. And the big thing that happened with Twitter Blue was that they decided we are going to give anybody who pays $8 a month the blue check mark. Now, on Twitter, for most of its existence, one of the big things that differentiated it from other platforms was the power of the verification check mark. It was a blue little badge that only Twitter staff could give you. So, hypothetically, say that you're Oprah Winfrey and you want to be on Twitter. But the problem is that there's about 500 other Oprah Winfrey accounts on Twitter. So how do you suss out who is the real Oprah Winfrey on Twitter.com? Twitter has a team called the verification team. And they would go to Oprah's people and go, which account is actually Oprah Winfrey? And they would go, it's this one. And Twitter would add the verification badge as well as a special status so that if you were searching for Oprah Winfrey on Twitter.com, you would find the verified real account. This is one of the key things that made Twitter so much more popular than other platforms was the fact that you had real celebrities on this platform and you could reach them by just replying to them or even direct messaging them. And it was incredibly lucrative in the early days of Twitter. And that status symbol, what the verification mark, became incredibly it became a clout chaser's dream. The idea was if you got that blue check mark, you had made it. You were someone. The blue check mark became something that only the elite got. Only the verified, people worthy of verification got. And Elon Musk, the world's richest man, decided to take this thing that has inherent built-in supply and demand, basic economic stuff, and he decided, I'm going to give this to everybody. Now, the inherent problem with that is that if you give the ability to claim that you are verified to literally everybody, the problem then becomes that anybody can claim now that they are Oprah Winfrey. And Twitter users, being well known for their ability to parse language, they're not looking at... Oops, the projector turned off. There we go. Twitter users are now looking at the little verification mark. And to their credit, I'm going to just say right now, to their credit, for the last 15 years, the Twitter verification symbol was simply you had your username, and then you had the badge to the right of the username. It just said username, and then you had the blue check mark. And that became the standard for 15 years. And then the new change was, okay, so hypothetically, you could have 500 different people who pay $8.99 a month and claim that they are, say, they say they're Oprah Winfrey. And all of them now have the verified mark. So how do you prove that Oprah is really who she says she is? Well, they did that by putting a tiny little bit of text under the username now that says official. But the blue check mark still remains in the top right-hand corner next to the username. That has not changed. So It's a logistical nightmare. Sorry, I was laughing. I choked on my own spit. I was laughing. You have created a situation where 500-plus people are now claiming to be Oprah Winfrey, and the one thing that separated the real Oprah Winfrey from all the imposters, anybody can buy for $8.99. So on the first day of Twitter Blue, you had things like AIPAC, I think that's the American-Israeli PAC, saying, "We love apartheid." You had Lockheed Martin, a.k.a. at Lockheed Martini. But the username, the name up here is Lockheed Martin. And look at that. It's verified, saying, "We will be halting all weapons sales to Saudi Arabia, Israel, and the United States until further investigations of their human rights abuses." You had BP Global with a verification mark saying, "Just because we killed the planet doesn't mean we can't miss it." Sad face emoji. You had Roblox, verified on the U.S., with a pretty official-looking Roblox underscore U.S. username saying, "We're adding sex to Roblox." And then you had Nintendo of Europe with a verification badge, a.k.a. at Nintendo Euro, with a picture of Shadow the Hedgehog, which is not a character owned by Nintendo, saying, "White people be watching porn." So obviously this was a disaster, and it was shut down very quickly, but not quickly enough, because the most famous example of what happened was this. The fake Eli Lilly Twitter account claims that insulin is now free. The stock fell 4.37%. That was a market cap of, according to Forbes.com, was roughly... Oh, shoot, I just had it. Oh, I'm sorry. I just lost it. Anyway. So basically, oh yeah, the day after the fake Eli Lilly accounts had issued their fake insulin tweets, Eli Lilly's stock share price tumbled by 4.37%, or 16.08, down to 352.30, as a blue checkmark creative and political activist pointed out. Did Twitter Blue's tweet just cost Eli Lilly billions? Yes. And podcaster Robert Evans, who I absolutely love and adore. Robert, if you're watching this, please top me. If Robert Evans pointed out, it costs some hero $8 to evaporate billions in Eli Lilly's stock value. Elon accidentally created one of the most cost-effective anti-capitalist tools in history. Because it's true. All someone has to do now, according to the new rules of the game, is just create a fake account. And then just put it out there like, "Oh yeah, I'm totally Eli Lilly. And by the way, insulin, it's free now." And you know what that did? It cost Eli Lilly literally billions of dollars in stock value. And the end result of it is Eli Lilly has decided that they are not going to be advertising on the platform anymore, because of course they're not. This Twitter just completely wiped out their... is so stupid. So, obviously, that was a terrible idea. So naturally, they're going to be bringing it back in 2 weeks. They are bringing back Blue Verified on November 29th. So get ready for all of this to repeat again, because they haven't made any changes to it. Let's be completely clear about that. No changes have been made. The whole thing about every tweet that I just showed you, it's all going to happen again. The only difference, as far as I can tell, is that Twitter Blue is not going to be available to accounts that have only existed for 100 days. So you're going to have accounts that have existed for years, as was the case with H3H3 Productions, when Ethan Klein of H3 decided that he was going to take his millions of followers on his account, change his name to Elon Musk, And then he tweeted out a bunch of inflammatory stuff that I can't say on the air. But he did that, and he got banned for it, but he was able to pull it off, and he had the verification badge well before Twitter Blue happened. You also had artists like Doja Cat who decided to change. They were like, I can't change my name. How do I change my name? And then they tried desperately to do so by contacting Elon Musk. And as soon as they get access to it, they just changed their name to Elon Musk. Because no one respects this guy. It's hilarious. Now, what is the importance of doing this show today? Well, my fellow fans of fog machines, the value of doing it today is because of this following thing, and this is the last thing we'll do on Twitter before we wrap it up here. Oops, sorry, wrong camera. Elon Musk demands Twitter staff commit to, quote, long hours or leave. The company-wide email ultimatum was sent around midnight San Francisco time and shared with CNBC, comes after Musk has already fired key executives, Twitter executives, laid off half of Twitter's full-time employees, slashed the number of contractors working with the company without notice. He sent a company-wide email to Twitter employees on Wednesday demanding that they commit to working long hours. He's demanding today at 5 p.m., as we're live right now, is the deadline. You either commit to what he's calling hardcore mode or you are given 3 months severance pay, but you're fired. Long hours at high intensity. That is what he is asking the remaining staff that he didn't fire and then ask to come back because he's the real life Tony Stark. He's just brilliant. You ever just like just read something and you're just exhausted? That's how I'm feeling right now. This person is worth over $200 billion. You could take $1 billion, and if you spent $1 million of it every day of your life for the rest of your life, you would not spend all of it. There are so many millions and millions of dollars that make up a billion. If you spent $1 billion, how do you even spend that? You know, besides buying one of the most popular and most powerful social media platforms on the planet, how do you actually spend billions of dollars? The truth is that you can't, practically. That's why billionaires kind of remain billionaires. They just sort of sit on their money like Smaug with his gold, and it's just a waste. There are people in my life, myself included, who are feeling the intense squeeze of income inequality. We can't afford the basics. It is very difficult to get the basics anymore. The cost of things like milk and bread and butter have risen significantly, and there's no relief in sight. The cost of gas has increased dramatically, and every time that it feels like the cost is going down, it goes back up again, and there isn't any relief in sight. During the pandemic, we were only given $1,400, and that was across two separate payments. That's all we were given for 2 years during a period where the entire world had shut down, and every day we were told, these are hard times, these are very strange times. You just have to stay strong. But we're not going to give you any resources to help out. Meanwhile, Donald Trump, while he was president, made a huge tax cut to the 1%. My taxes went up. And all that tax money went to people like this. And what does he do with that money? What is he actually doing? What is the value of having billions of dollars when it's like, this is what he's doing? What is he doing? What's the point of having billions and billions of dollars? Seriously. Does anybody need this much money when... What do you buy with that? What do you buy with that? Is it simply that, like, it's just like a source of comfort? That you just have, like, billions of dollars and you're just like, well, I'm good. Because I'll point out something right now. If you look to the right-hand side over here, and I don't know if you can see it very well, the one that I'm highlighting down here in the bottom right-hand corner. This is a cryptocurrency dude. He ran the platform FTX, and it had billions of dollars worth of assets, and he was on the Fortune 500 list of, like, the big up-and-comers, and he was, like, one of the top entrepreneurs in the country during their last magazine spread on when it was, like, you know, 30 under 30 or whatever they do. And he just blew billions of dollars off of cryptocurrency, which is arguably not that hard to do. And it's the largest collapse of any financial market within crypto in crypto's history. It's literally billions of dollars are just gone. And what do you even say at this point? It's just exhausting. It's just like, what do you even say at this point? He's gonna do Twitter Blue, reloaded, blue verified, November 29th, to make sure it's rock solid. I'm just exhausted, you guys. I'm just exhausted. So, he does Twitter Blue, and then today, well, yesterday, I should say, yesterday was the day that he puts out the email saying that you need to get prepared to do long hours at high intensity or receive 3 months of severance, that they did not consent to the conditions or support his vision for Twitter 2.0. He is asking the remaining employees to work 80-hour weeks. 80-hour weeks. He's asking them to do this because he's an idiot and he fired 3,000 people without notice, which is illegal, by the way. You have to give 3 months of notice. And he did this and he's just like, I'm a billionaire. I can just get rid of it. The word from the inside is basically, this is Elon Musk. He lands rockets on platforms. He sends rockets to the moon. He doesn't care about the FEC fining him. He doesn't care about the FEC fining him. He sends rockets to the moon. He's a real-life Tony Stark. And I know I keep saying that, but it's just like, again, I'm just exhausted. So he's... I want to get into my personal thoughts on all this. I just wanted to give the background to it. Now that we've gone through the bulk of what actually has happened, I want to give my thoughts on it. I genuinely hope that this kills Twitter. I hate Twitter. I hate Twitter so much. I have seen the best minds of my generation destroyed by this madness. Starving, hysterical, naked, dragging themselves through their feeds at all hours of the day, looking for their angry fix. These angel-headed hipsters with their connection to some starry dynamo. I've seen so many people in my life personally be consumed by clout chasing in particular, but like this madness on Twitter in particular. The platform was created after the election, especially to incite anger. The whole point of the platform in the last few years has been to make people angry, to yell at each other, because that is engagement. I've talked about this before. I think I mentioned this on last week's show. But there was a Daily Beast article that I haven't been able to find. But it was, I believe, Will Sommer. And he interviewed teenagers. And he was like, what is social media like for you guys? What is being on your phone like for teenagers? And all the teens, universally, when they were asked, like, what's it like for you guys to be on your phones? All of them said one word. Boring. It's boring. They all described just swiping up on their phones, just swiping up and just going through these endless, infinite scrolling feeds and just desperately looking for something to stimulate them. I think that people mistake the fact that you are constantly checking the app, checking your notifications, looking through the feed constantly. You think that that's entertainment. You think that that's fun. It is not fun. It's boring, but it's addictive. It's an addictive kind of boredom because it makes you angry. There is some kind of content on there that gets to you. And if they can get to you, they can keep you on the platform. Because you know what happens when you keep scrolling? You get served ads. And that is 86% of Twitter's revenue. Twitter's revenue is 86% advertisements, and the rest of it is like outsourcing their technology to other firms. They literally only have like two or three forms of revenue, and the bulk of it is in advertising. And that is why it is such a destructive platform. The entire platform from head to toe is created and made to make you angry. And the effect of that long term has been it has made our country more divided and angrier at each other. And we're all just supposed to accept this and move on. And here comes this hero who buys out the platform that has made everyone angry and seemingly within just a week has decided, like, I'm going to kill it. And it's not intentional. He did not want to kill this platform on purpose. But Elon Musk is an idiot. He is not a business savant. And he is probably going to kill Twitter because you know what's realistically going to happen? All these employees have been given this notice of like, you're going to either work 80 hours or you're going to get out. And you know what's going to happen? All these employees are going to get out. And who's going to run the service? There's already news from the platform today from people who are regularly on there saying it is buggy. It is not working. It is happening right now. As I am live right now, the ultimatum has hit its deadline. And we don't even know yet who is still there and who has decided to sign a severance package. But I hope to God no one stays on. This is not Whiplash. This is not going to be J.K. Simmons trying to train a young drummer into disciplining him into being the best drummer he can be. This isn't like that. No one is going to be whiplashed into shape and become a better programmer thanks to Elon Musk making you go through hardcore mode. Twitter is a terrible platform. It is bad for everyone's soul. And the best thing that Elon Musk may ever do in his entire life is be the person who killed it within 2 weeks of him owning it. And that is just wonderful. I hope he does. And I mean this sincerely, and I will say this on camera. If Elon Musk kills Twitter, I will unironically defend him one time like his weird fans do all the time. I will lovingly do whatever to defend him. Just once. I will also add that, completely unrelated to this, I will always defend him as the person who killed Twitter because I genuinely believe this. I am not on Twitter. I have not been on Twitter for quite some time. I rejoined recently because the only way that you can flag like neo-Nazi content is you have to have an account on these platforms. So I created a new account, and I saw myself getting kind of sucked into the algorithm. It is very addictive. They're very good at creating this platform in a way that makes you just like want to constantly check it when you're idle. It's not very fun, though, but it is addictive. And I found myself checking it constantly. And I just decided, like, I hate this. And I don't want to be here anymore. So I deleted it. And I don't miss it. And before that, I had not been on Twitter for roughly 3 years. And I left at that point because it was making me angrier and it was making me a worse person overall, because I would look at people who I disagreed with and I would feel like a mob mentality to join in with them and to attack the other, whoever that might be. And in retrospect, I cannot remember a single person who I actually attacked. I just know that I did, because that's what the platform encouraged. And to anybody out there who I might have hurt with that, I'm genuinely sorry. I don't want to excuse my actions. I was the one that was a part of it. We all were. But I felt encouraged to attack other human beings. And there's a difference between attacking like a neo-Nazi for being a neo-Nazi. There is no defensible course of action there. There's nothing defensible about that ideology. But like, Bean Dad? Do we all really care about Bean Dad? Was it worth the hell that we put that person through? You know? Like, I think a lot of people are looking at Twitter and they're saying, like, the actual demise of this platform and going, like, what are we going to do? This thing that's been in my life this entire time, like, how do you possibly replace this platform that is, like, the backbone of everything? And I'm sorry, but we existed before Twitter and we're going to be fine. We're going to be better off without it. News websites have gotten better at being able to update their websites in real time. And that's like the only real thing that I can think of that like Twitter brought us. And like, we've gotten better at this. We can do this. We have the technology and it's off Twitter. So I believe that we have a future without Twitter, and I genuinely believe it's going to be a better one. Something else about Twitter, neo-Nazis are still on it. And I wanted to bring this up real quick because I was not at this book fair, but I was going to go, but I had to paint my bedroom. So instead, I focused on that instead. This was at the Anarchist Book Fair in Harvard Square. And you have these little dweebs down here. Look at these. Look at these stick figure boys. Look at these little dweebs. Look at them. Okay, listen. I'm not being edgy. I'm not saying these things because I'm trying to instigate or incite whatever. I'm sure that they'll all come to my house. They'll be very scary. I'll be very intimidated. I'm sorry. These people look like dweebs. It's all black shirts and khaki pants and no muscle. I know they don't need muscle. That's why they have the guns. But I'm sorry. I'm not intimidated by these people. They look like dweebs. They look like I could throw them. They look like javelins that you'd throw at the Olympics. Like, no wonder they're all neo-Nazis. Like, this, they are the exact kind of people that, like, you look at them and they're like, yeah, of course you're a neo-Nazi. This is the only thing you have to live for. You know, they have that term in the 4chan circles, NEET, N-E-E-T, not in education. I forgot it. But it's like not in education, something else with the E, or training. Neat. It's basically someone who has no life skills, who has nothing really to bring to the table. These are people who end up working at like McDonald's or something like that. And there isn't necessarily anything wrong with someone who works at McDonald's, but there's a difference between like hating on someone because you're a Karen and you're like, why do people who work at McDonald's deserve like $20 an hour? Like they said, and then the pandemic happens and you're like, I miss McDonald's. Like people who work at McDonald's are heroes. They're good people and I love them. If you work at McDonald's, you're a good person and I love you. But it also doesn't change the fact that there are a lot of people who end up being, you know, losers. And the best they can do in life is either end up at a McDonald's or become a neo-Nazi, apparently. And I have no problem making fun of someone who decides, oh yeah, my ideological path in life is this flawed ideology that blames all of my problems on the Jews. Like seriously, look at this. Look at these dweebs and be like, oh yeah, the problem here is Judaism. That's the problem. The problem with these guys, when I look at these guys, I think of Judaism. And I'm like, wow, Jews really control the world. And that's the problem here, you know? And they're definitely, like, when I see this and I'm just like, yeah, a bunch of angry boys, angry white boys in the street. Yeah, the Judaism's real bad. Oh my God, you dorks. You absolute losers. You dweebs. Anyway, these boys are from the group NSC 131. So let's talk very briefly about them. You know, if you've ever watched this show before, first of all, thank you. But secondly, if you've seen one Nazi group, you've seen them all. They all basically believe in the same things, and they all eventually fall apart. Because as we've talked about before on the show, it is the resting position of a hate group to hate. So naturally, the hate groups are going to turn on each other. You can see that just in the past week with the Republican Party all turning on Donald Trump literally on a dime. Literally, it was like overnight. Like, Donald Trump announces he's going to run for president, and even Fox News was like, nope, don't care. And they just turned the TV off. They literally just moved on to something else. They didn't even play all of his announcement speech. That is hate groups in a nutshell. When you hate, you eventually backstab. And NSC 131 is the next incarnation of it. It's one of those things. It's like, I'm making two predictions on this episode. I'm predicting that Twitter is going to fail within a week. Today is November 17th, 2022 AD. I'm predicting that within 7 days of now, Twitter will completely collapse and it will no longer be a functional website. Like, literally, you will go to twitter.com in your browser and it'll just be a 404 error. I am predicting it. It's got a week. It's got 1 week. I am calling it right now. Because, again, the ultimatum was at 5 o'clock today, as we're live right now on the 17th. You're either going to work 80-hour weeks or you are going to take a 3-month severance, but you're fired. So who's going to work these 80-hour weeks for not great pay comparatively? Like, if you're working 80-hour weeks but you're salaried, you're not getting an increase, you know? So who's going to take that deal? A moron, an idiot. Someone who's like in the weird Elon Musk cult is going to take that deal. And there's not going to be enough people to run the website, and it is going to collapse. Like, we didn't even get into the fact he turned off two-factor authorization. We didn't even have time for that. National Socialist Club 131, a.k.a. NSC 131. Let's see. What do they believe in? What do the neo-Nazis believe in? What could the neo-Nazis believe? Oh, it's the same things as usual. They believe themselves to be soldiers at war with a hostile Jewish-controlled system that is deliberately plotting the extinction of the white race. Very original, very, very thoughtful. They seek to form an underground network of weird little boys who started out their ideology with Gamergate, who are willing to fight against their perceived enemies through localized direct actions. Now, who are their enemies? The Jews, trans people, probably black people, probably Hispanic people. Being honest, probably. NSC espouses racism. Anti-Semitism and intolerance via the internet, propaganda distributions, and the use of graffiti. NSC participates in localized flash demonstrations, counter-protests, and makes appearances at mainstream events. NSC engages in schemes to troll or otherwise harass those who oppose them. They are going to collapse within a year, if not sooner. It is so dumb. These people are so dumb. They're adorable. Let me just pull up the photo of them again. Let's see here. First of all, no, it wasn't down there. Here it is. Look at them. Look at the neo-Nazis. Look at them. You're so tough. Look at you. You're so tough. I'm not afraid of them. I'm sorry. I'm just not. They could literally murder me. They could torture me to death. And I'm still never going to be afraid of them. I'm never going to see them. You might notice I'm not calling them men. They're not men. These are not men. Manhood is earned. These are not boys who have earned their manhood. These are children. We're looking at children here. And their actions are childish. This is not legitimate political action. You're not going to just go up to people in the street and violently lunge at them like they did in this dweeb video here. You know what he's doing there? You know the guy in the front? You know what this boy is doing? He's lunging. He's lunging aggressively. He's going, "What? What?" And you wonder why I'm not intimidated by them. The only thing they've got are those black hoods and khakis. And also, incidentally, notice how they're all wearing masks. You know, these are the same people that during the pandemic they refused to. These are the people that made the pandemic go on because they refused to, they just refused. They were just like, oh, my freedom. And these are incidentally the same people where if you look at their messages and all their message boards, these are the same idiots that will go like, I would bleed for this country. I'll die for this country. I love America so much. I love freedom in my country, and I love America. I would die for this country. Okay, put on a mask. Put on a mask before you go to Denny's. It was tyranny. Endless tyranny. It's just tyranny. Ugh. These people are dorks. I love them. They're so stupid. You know, the one thing I'll say is that at least they're out there doing stuff. It's not a good positive. I didn't say it was a good thing. Luckily, it's not going to last very long. I was talking to one of the women who works here before the show today, because we only have like a few minutes left. Thank you for watching, by the way. I was talking to Tina, who's out in the lobby right now, and I told her that basically during the Iraq War, I think we all saw that footage of, like, Al-Qaeda members training on the monkey bars, and they were, like, doing the thing. And it was kind of laughable, but studies found afterwards that basically that footage being played over and over again on CNN and other networks had the effect of making the enemy seem much larger than it actually was. In reality, the terrorist groups were, like, a couple hundred guys, if that. Very low, like, thousands, but generally hundreds. But because we kept seeing the same like monkey bar climbing training videos or whatever of them in their little terrorist camps, picture unrelated, they seemed bigger than they actually were. The other side of that is that we didn't really care that much because the perception was, oh, this is all happening over there. So we don't really need to worry about it here in comfy America. Well, this is Harvard Square. I literally bike past exactly where they're standing every day when I go to work. These people are in Harvard Square. They are here. This is domestic terrorism. These are literal Nazis. Well, not literal Nazis, but neo-Nazis. And they're here. And the only benefit to covering them is that by increasing the scrutiny on them, you are making them seem much more important and bigger than they are, which in this case is actually not a terrible thing, in my opinion, because you are effectively making the scrutiny on them much more intense. None of us want neo-Nazis to be here. And luckily, we're kind of putting the spotlight on them and they're